that. You're not going to screw this up, are you?
You know who I
am. Are you son?
No.
Thank you.
Opens its doors at Cambridge, Massachusetts in 1636, Harvard University has maintained a standard of educational excellence rivaling that of any college in the world. Since it first opened its doors at Cambridge, Massachusetts in 1636, Harvard University has maintained a standard of educational excellence rivaling that of any college in the world. Combining high academic achievement with the Ivy League's traditional love of sports, this campus continues to enjoy an intense loyalty on the part of its alumni that approaches obsession. And tempered by the rich experience of its 300 years, Harvard stands ready for the future, prepared to carry the proud traditions of the Crimson into the coming century and beyond.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Bob Hope.
Thank you. I've never played a birthday cake before. Can you believe Harvard was founded in 1636 and here I am standing on its stage? Who would have thought it would last that long, huh?
I don't
don't want to say this is an old school, but the administration building has liver spots. I thought I'd give you a chance with that. No, that's true. I don't feel quite at home where the students write home for money in Latin. There was a course in religion. If you flunked, you were shipped to Salem and burned at the stake. Now, for over 300 years, Harvard has been producing more politicians than any other university in the world, but they've made up for it many other ways. Now, the School for Politicians gives new meaning to a BS degree. Hey, and I love that Winthrop House dorm where all the Kennedys roomed, or as it's otherwise... I have more where the Kennedys roomed, or as it's otherwise known, White House North. That was the more. And Harvard's had more Nobel Prize than any other university in the world. I think that's great. It's the only way a professor can make more money than the football player he flunked. And Harvard is one of the richest schools in the world. Of course, it's easy to get money when pictures of the alumni are printed on it.
Mr. Beatty, my name is Heather Woodruff. I'm a first year here at the college. Uh-huh. And I'm curious why you criticize the salary disparity of CEOs that seemingly hurt the equality, but fail to mention the disparity between actors who make millions for each film.
Very good. Very good. You've mentioned it. Done. Good for you.
Do you have any type of agenda or any type of views?
No.
Not at all.
And if he was honestly being fair with himself, he would realize he didn't either. We do comedy shows, and we tell jokes about things that we care about. And if you guys find that interesting and enjoy it, that's great too. But if I truly had an agenda about changing things, I would probably be working with groups that do that. I mean, there are groups out there that work tirelessly towards social change, and then there are people who work on a network that has robots that fight each other. I mean, it's the idea that I would, you know, in my mind say, I would like to affect the political process, and you know the best way I think to do it is to follow the film Mannequin 3. I think that comedians, when they say, I'm affecting social change, are assholes.
Art, activity of creating things that arouse the emotions through one or more senses. That's an artifact, a fact. Here is an art effect, meaning here is art in effect. Nobody does it, do it quite like we do it, does it? Some tried to do it, but they fake, and we knew it. Was it Chu that was saying that hip-hop was decaying, that it wasn't lasting? We blasting and passing with a passion, your style and your fashion. Unmasking America, massive hysteria. If you want the real, KRS will take care of you. Her name well-known in all inner-city areas. I'm not your superior or inferior. I'm in your interior. That's why I'm hearing you. I bust a rhyme like a last Boy Scout and beat a Punisher like Fat Joe, no doubt. To the beat, y'all, you don't stop. On stage, it ain't about your hit. You gotta grab the microphone like a bone all alone. The skills that are shown leaves the whole place blown. The place that I'm talking about be hip-hop. The place I be walking about be hip-hop. MCing, DJing, graph, breaking, beatboxing, philosophy, and management. To these arenas in hip-hop, be passionate. Some be attacking it, but we're not having it. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was made flesh. KRS. Thank you.
magic dragon is an assertion that it is sad when we lose our belief in dragons. And indeed, as adults, it is sad if we lose our belief in our ideals and we become cynical, as this country has become. There'll be new songs, and there'll be old songs too. And Puff will continue to be played as well and misunderstood, because it never was about grass. The magic dragon lived by the sea and frolicked in the autumn mist in a land called Annalee. Once again, Puff, the magic dragon lives by the sea, present tense, and frolics in the autumn mist in a land called Annalee. That's it for Puff.
My name is Paul. I'm a student here at the Kennedy School. My question is simply, will you go out on a date with me tonight?
Okay, what?
Little candlelight dinner, maybe?
One question. Can I ask Shelley? Shelley, would it be okay if I went out with him? She said she didn't care.
I remember when Al asked me to talk to some of his constituents, and he brought in a whole group from Wyoming, and he was introducing me, and someone got up and said, Kennedy's a horse's tail, or words to that effect, and Al grabbed that person and threw him out of the room, and I said, well, I didn't know that this was Kennedy country, and he said, well, it isn't. It's horse country. And
we do have some special guests who want to pay final tribute to usher us out.
I was on a plane some years ago, and there was a man that got on board, and he was drunk, and he was swearing and cursing and pinching this attendant, and everybody was upset with him, and somebody whispered to him that Billy Graham is on here, and he said, you don't say. And he got up, said, yes, he's right behind you. And so he got up, he came back, and he said, are you Billy Graham? And I said, yes. He said, put her there. He said, your sermons have sure helped me.
This question isn't tough at all, and it's not even really about economics, but I would feel bad if I had the opportunity to speak to the Secretary of the Treasury and didn't ask this question. I have a $1 bill here, and it's signed by Lawrence H. Summers, Secretary of the Treasury. And my question, sir, is I'm curious, first of all, what it was like for you to sign this, what would become the $1 bill. And second, what it feels like every time you spend money that your signature is on.
My children refer to good money and bad money. Good money is that which has daddy's signature.
I think you'd get a kick out of this. This is really fun. When you're up there, you get, before you're going to go to bed at night and get into your sleeping bag, which is tethered with, you know, bungees, so you just float in the middle, zip the thing up. But anyway, you usually had 15 or 20 minutes, and one of the best times I had was, you can take a water bag, and you can squeeze the water out, and it runs up this little tube, you know, and you take the stopper off of it, run it up, and if you squeeze it just slow enough, why, the water comes out and collects just like a little ball, like a golf ball or tennis ball right here off that, and you can pull the tube out, and there it floats, and surface tension makes it into a perfect sphere. And you can blow on it like that, and it'll go ripples around it, and it'll stop. And you can blow it, and it'll go floating across. And somebody else can blow it, and it'll come back over towards you. But this is I thought this was pretty cool. One night I had put the straw back into that thing I was playing with, and blew a bubble in the middle of it. And so I had a water ball with a nice bubble in the middle of it. I had been drinking some grape juice, and so I took the grape juice and put grape juice in. So I had a beautiful water ball with grape juice color and a bubble in the middle of it. So you get to do some things like that up there too. Thank you.
Queen Ant mobilized the troops to go out and look for food. And presently, one day, a group of ants that she'd sent out, a detachment, came galloping back down the hill to where this ant colony was situated halfway down to say that a fine piece of food, horse manure, had just been discovered at the top of the hill. And she mobilized a force out to bring it back. And it was necessary to hold against it because the hill was steep and there was danger that it would go right down and be lost. So she got more and more of her troops to hold against it. And she went up and down with her antennae going like this, which in ant language means, stop that horse shit. And I would look down my table and my very reputable staff would be going like this.
I've often been asked, how do you see the Kennedy School? And I've always had the same answer. The day passes, night comes, Harvard closes down, and the Kennedy School comes alive.
Well, the Kennedy School is about ready to come to life this evening. Thank you all very much for coming out on such a rainy, cold evening. We think this is going to be very worth your while. I'm Jean Shaheen. I'm the director at the Institute of Politics, which, as most of you know, is the part of the Kennedy School that runs the forum. I think almost every night in the forum is special, and you've just seen a number of moments from forums over the years which have been real highlights. I think probably other than the White House or the United Nations, there's no other place in the world that has hosted so many prominent figures. This is a remarkable space. It's one where we can experience ideas and share passions and excitement about what's going on here, and usually do it in a way that's civil, that respects the ideas and thoughts of others. Many of you here are forum junkies. You know that there's no experience more magical than attending one of the forums where we have that kind of debate and discussion. I know that I've heard conversations from students here, from faculty, from people who have said, gee, I wished I had seen that form the other night. And how many times have you heard David Elwood or Graham Allison or Joe McCarthy reminisce about one of the wonderful forums from days past? Well, tonight, the Institute of Politics is proud to unveil our forum archive, an opportunity for all of you and people around the world to go back and look at some of those wonderful forums from years past. You can see something that happened last week, last year, or even before a lot of you were born. The new online video archive features hundreds of speeches, debates, discussions by some of the world's most prominent political figures. It goes all the way back to 1978, and it also offers visitors a search engine to fully explore its contents. It makes the library's rich historical material accessible to anyone in the world with a computer. Before we begin to unveil some of the special moments from the Forum Archive with some of the very special people here at the Kennedy School, I wanted to thank the people who really worked to make this happen. First of all, thanks to everyone on the IOP staff, and I'm not going to go through and name them all, but if everybody here from the Institute of Politics would just raise your hand so that we can thank you for all of the work that you've done to make this possible. There are special thanks that go to a few people on the IOP staff. To Kathy McLaughlin, who's the executive director at the IOP and who helped to envision this project. And to the forum staff, who are not just here tonight for this forum, but who are here every night working all hours to make the forums happen, and who have done so much to make this project happen for everyone. I'm going to ask Bill White, who is the head of the forum staff, Kathy Park, and especially two people, Greg Wilson from the forum staff and Jessica Jacobs, who really did the technology piece of the forum archive to make it happen. If you all would just raise your hands, let everybody thank you for all of the work that you've done. And then we have the two people who actually did the digitization of all of those videos so that we can have this forum archive. Harry Braveman and Leanne Jacobellis, thank you, who worked to make this happen. Thank you both. Now, tonight, to explore this incredible archive, we've invited a number of faculty, some staff, and some students to share with all of us their favorite clips from years past. And of course, to start kicking off this evening tonight, who better to bring back to the stage but the person who was here at the start of the forum, somebody who all of you here know, who knows the history of the Kennedy School probably as well as anyone here, Graham Allison. It's nice to have you here.
Very nice to be here, and on behalf of myself, but I'm sure everybody here, let me congratulate you and the forum team for this extraordinary idea, even of digitizing this and making it available for everybody. I look forward to having a chance to see it.
Good. Well, we're pleased that you're here to share with us some of the history of forums past, and I know that you're going to start with a clip that shows the dedication ceremony of the Kennedy School. And I heard there were some strange things that happened at that ceremony, but I gather you're not going to show us those.
Well, I'm not in charge of which clips are shown. It certainly, the dedication was an extraordinary event. This is back almost 30 years ago, 1978. The school was just barely emerging, and it had gone through some rocky periods. The JFK Presidential Library had meant to be on this site. It had been ejected by some so-called people power movement from people on Brattle Street who thought that if the JFK Library were here in Cambridge, people from Oklahoma in Bermuda shorts with an RV would come and ruin the character of Harvard Square. That was the argument. In any case, it was a nonsense argument, but they succeeded. But the school then built on this site, and so the dedication was a kind of a coming out party. We had Arthur Fiedler and the Harvard band, and Teddy Kennedy gave a wonderful speech. Jackie O was there, and John and Carolyn, and the rest of the members of the family. I think Mike Dukakis, maybe. I can't remember. He was the governor or just had been the governor. The best speech of the day, sort of befitting a school of government, was given by a black kid, a student in the college who was protesting. A speech which I must say, as the dean, we certainly had not scheduled, and which I had thought should not occur. But in any case, it did. So it started off with a bang. Yeah.
Good. I don't think we're going to see that speech, but we are going to see one that is equally memorable.
Most of all, perhaps, he would have loved the forum, so brilliantly created here as a link between Harvard and ancient Greece and Rome. A crossroads by day and a meeting place by night. An arena for debate where democracy can come alive in the town and university community. A forum where citizens can meet with presidents and kings, or poets, or debate with secretaries of defense. You can almost hear the echoes from the future now. My brother would have laughed at the thought of debating Richard Nixon in the forum here before the League of Women Voters. And now he would have relished a seminar in which students and professors disputed his handling of the Cuban Missile Crisis, and how he would have loved the chance of an evening here to chastise Russell Long or Jack Kemp or Bill Buckley for taking his name in vain to justify their doubtful schemes for massive tax reductions.
I don't know if you could see the background, but just behind Teddy when he was speaking was Mrs. Onassis, and then sitting beside her was John, for whom the forum is now named, and Carolyn. And then in the back, the sort of distinguished-looking gentleman that you could see was Don Price, the former dean of the school.
Well, before we let you go, I want you to share with us a clip from a forum that you organized with Robert McNamara and Ted Sorensen, one that Senator Kennedy actually mentioned in that clip, on the Cuban Missile Crisis. This is a forum that Bill White says is the very best forum that was ever organized. So you want to set this up for us?
Well, let me make sure what... this is the 13 days with McNamara?
Yes.
Yeah. The Kevin Costner made a movie called 13 Days. There's a long story associated with that, particularly after he had been involved in the Oliver Stone JFK movie. They first came to me and were hoped that I would be a consultant for the movie, and I told them I thought the travesty involved in the JFK movie was so great that I was looking forward to blasting their movie in the review, which I thought would be a lousy movie as well. In any case, thanks to the producers, including a fellow named Peter Allman, they then made a very serious effort to make the 13 Days a docudrama that the messages of which were at least authentic. And in the end, they were pretty successful. So we did a forum event in which we did clips from the 13 Days, and I think had McNamara, who at the time of the real missile crisis was the Secretary of Defense, and the person whom President John F. Kennedy said afterwards was the most valuable participant in the Cuban Missile Crisis, and Ted Sorensen, who was the president's closest associate and speechwriter, and had some back and forth. But since I haven't seen the excerpt yet, I don't know exactly where it goes from there.
Well, for those of you who are too young to remember the Cuban Missile Crisis, I think it should be pretty apparent who Robert McNamara is in this clip.
Ship was firing star shells. Well, star shell flares, Mr. Secretary. God damn it, I've got a job to do here. Now, you've been camped out up there since Monday night. You're tired, you're exhausted, you're making mistakes. You interfere with me and you will get some of my men killed, and I will not allow that.
Star shells.
Get out of our way, Mr. Secretary. The Navy's been running blockade since the days of John Paul Jones.
I believe the President made it clear that there will be no firing on ships without his express permission.
With all due respect, Mr. Secretary, we were not firing on that ship.
What the hell was that?
Firing on a ship means attacking a ship. We were not attacking that ship. We were firing over it.
That was not the President's intention when he gave that order. What if the Soviets don't see the distinction? What if they make the same mistake I just made? There will be no firing anything near any Soviet ship without my express permission. Now, is that understood, Admiral? Is it?
Yes, sir.
And I will only issue such instructions when ordered to by the President. John Paul Jones! You don't understand a thing, do you, Admiral? This is not a blockade. This is language. A new vocabulary, the likes of which the world has never seen. This is President Kennedy communicating with Secretary Khrushchev.
So what do you have to say for yourself?
Well, I'll just say two quick words. First, notice how much better looking he is now. The second is that Admiral Anderson's revolt, that's how ambassadors to Portugal are made.
Shortly after this event, the Chief of Naval Operations found himself as ambassador to Portugal.
Thanks, Graham. Next, let me ask Linda Bilmes to the stage, someone else you are all familiar with. But what you may not know about our faculty member, Linda Bilmes, is that she was also an IOP student when she was here as an undergraduate. She was very active in the Institute of Politics. And I think you have a clip from those days of Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan to share with us.
Yes, I do, and I'm really thrilled to be here tonight. I went to college at Harvard and to graduate school at Harvard Business School, and I can honestly say that some of the most memorable nights of my student career that I am allowed to discuss were spent here in the forum. And now that I'm teaching here, it's really exciting to have this this archive. And I'm going to show you a clip of Senator Daniel Patrick Moynihan, who is, he sadly died about 3 years ago, but one of the really extraordinary human beings of the 20th century. This is a man who was born poor, son of a deadbeat dad, grew up in Hell's Kitchen, and he, when you think about a career you want, this is the dude. This is the real thing. This is a guy who was ambassador to the UN, ambassador to India, U.S. senator, who worked for four presidents, Kennedy, Johnson, Ford, and Nixon. This is a guy who wrote 19 books. They used to say in the Senate that he actually had written more books than most senators have read. Probably no truer thing ever said. He launched a lot of careers. Ralph Nader's first job was working for him. And an awful lot of people, including, I think, possibly our own Dean Elwood, were inspired very much in their careers by his example. He was also someone who, it's kind of hard to describe what he was like, because he was such an unusual person. He was, in the way he dressed, in the way he talked, he sort of plunked the words out, like he was playing a funny kind of guitar. And it's great to have a forum to be able to sort of look and watch at how interesting he was when he spoke. He was also someone who was very influential to me in my career. I met him as when I was an undergraduate, and he was someone who was a real social scientist and believed in the power of data. And when students ask me, how did you get interested in budgets, which seems like a really boring thing, how did you get interested in that, I say, if I am being actually honest, it was because Daniel Patrick Moynihan, when I first met him, talked to me about the power of data, the power of information, and he used to always say, people are entitled to different opinions, but they're not entitled to different facts. And I would just say that I saw him at the forum that we're going to see in 1983, and I had known him as a student, but then I had not seen him for 15 years until I was in the Clinton administration. I met him 15 years later, and can you imagine if one of your professors does this? He walked over to me as if he had seen me yesterday and said, hi, Linda, you know, what are you doing, et cetera, I see you're in the administration. I mean, he followed all his students' careers over all this time. A truly extraordinary human being and man, and it's great to see a little clip of him, which doesn't even begin to do justice to how cool he was, but we can get a little clip of it. Thank you.
Using the model of the econometric model that has been produced here in Cambridge, and the Joint Economic Committee now has, we suggested what would happen if you went back to the president's pad and then sloped back down to where it would be in 1986, kept defense at 5%, did a few more things like that. The model told the machine produced quite extraordinary results. And so we submitted this to the Budget Committee one afternoon. About 10 o'clock at night, I got a telephone call from Paul Volcker. That we were interfering with monetary policy. I said, but Paul, we're not interfering with monetary policy. We're just trying to do what the president said he would do. And then I went on saying, now on February 28th, there was this set of papers and it was issued and said this passage. Don't tell me about that passage. He said, I wrote that passage. Well, what is that relationship in which the chairman writes, but it's anonymous, and some people know, and later they find out, and no one is sure, and in any event, what you said you would do, you don't do. If you wrote that passage, why didn't you follow that policy? And it is not the individual, it is the institutional arrangement.
Doesn't begin to do the man justice, but he was an amazing guy, and it was a great forum. Congratulations, Gene, and to the Institute of Politics for doing this fabulous archive.
Thank you, Linda. Richard Parker, of course you all know, is another member of the faculty here at the Kennedy School, who really wanted to show a clip of John Kenneth Galbraith, because you all know about his book on Galbraith. But I think we ask you not to do that because he was in the opening clips. So. We appreciate that that's what you really wanted to do, Richard, but you're going to show us something else instead, right?
It is a tribute to the Kennedy School's versatility that I have moved from talking about a very tall white guy to a very small black guy. I am going to introduce Archbishop Desmond Tutu. Here at the Kennedy School, faculty, I think, rightfully pride ourselves on teaching you how to govern. But I think oftentimes we don't do enough to teach you about how to envision and then realize the moral ends that make up a democratic society. Desmond Tutu has never made that mistake. The Archbishop of Cape Town, a Nobel Prize winner, a man who has spent his life fighting in South Africa against apartheid and around the world against evil and injustice in all forms, Desmond Tutu was a guest to the Kennedy School in January 1986, just a year after winning the Nobel Prize for Peace. By then, the Kennedy School knew not a small amount about the impact of apartheid, because a few years before, Harvard, the Kennedy School actually, had been offered a $1 million grant for its new library if the school would agree to name the library after an extremely wealthy investor in South African gold and Diamonds, who some have rumored for a long time, was Ian Fleming's model for Goldfinger. Now, Harvard doesn't happily give up a $1 million grant, but Dean Allison did exactly that. And he gave it up in a way after consulting with students and faculty here and across the university who were profoundly concerned about the implications of Harvard's association with apartheid. And I think it's something we should honor him for tonight and every night when we gather here in the forum. That kind of courage is singular and a mark of who Graham Allison is. Desmond Tutu spoke that night to thank students, not only here at Harvard, but across America, for the work that they had been doing in the 1970s and 1980s to help overthrow the regime of apartheid in South Africa. He quoted at one point in the talk a speech by President Kennedy, among the very last that President Kennedy gave, at Amherst College in October 1963, and I'd like to read to you the lines that were quoted. "The men who create power make an indispensable contribution to the nation's greatness, but the men and women who question power make a contribution just as indispensable, for it is they who determine whether we use power or power uses us." This is Desmond Tutu thanking the students for using power rather than letting power use us.
But something happened in this country, didn't it? People power happened, which dramatically altered, what, the ball game? It certainly dramatically altered the moral texture of what was happening around here. So that Congress had to take note of the mood of the people. And the president of this country had to take note. And because he feared something that was undreamt of in 1984, a veto override, he had to adjust his so-called constructive engagement policy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Richard. We're still dealing with a few technical issues on the archive, so hopefully by the time you get to this on your computer, it won't look as dark as it did tonight. Now I want to ask one of the Kennedy School student body, Lisa George, who is, you all know, is the student body president here at the Kennedy School, to come up and introduce a clip about one of our favorite historians, Doris Kearns Goodwin. Lisa.
Thank you very much. I feel like I'm on Oprah tonight, so I'm going to soak it all up. Thank you. So Doris Kearns Goodwin, one of the greatest historians of our time. And when I think of a historian, of a good historian, I think of someone who is an amazing storyteller. Someone who can weave together a story in such a way that the reader or the listener is just drawn in, just sucked in, feels the emotion of the story. Whether it's about a great triumph or a great tragedy, or about a solemn moment or a light one. And really, I don't think anyone does it better than Doris Kearns Goodwin. When she came to the forum in 1991, she was here to talk about the legacy of President Lyndon Johnson, of whom she wrote about in her very first biography. And I wasn't here in 1991. I've only had the pleasure of seeing a few forums, but I've never seen her speak in person either. But the thing that really struck me about this clip when I watched it and really jumped out of the computer screen when I was watching it was her gift as a storyteller, her ability to weave these stories together. And as you'll see in this clip, she has an uncanny ability of making you feel as if you're in the room at the moment looking at President Johnson as the story unfolds. And I thought that that was just amazing. And I loved it. And I think that that's just one of the wonderful events, moments that we've had at the forum. So enjoy.
He brings Wallace into the White House Oval Office. Wallace stood only about 5'2" tall. Johnson was, of course, like 6'3" and 200 pounds. So he immediately put Wallace in this low plush couch so that Wallace sunk even further down to the floor. And then he seated himself in this hard rocking chair, and he leaned over to Wallace so that his nose is almost touching Wallace's. And then with a flash of brilliance, he talks to him about all sorts of things. He says, I saw you criticizing me today, George. And he says, no, no, sir, I wasn't criticizing you. I was just criticizing, you know, states' rights. I was defending. And he said, no, I saw you on that television screen. You was criticizing me, George. I have three televisions, you know, and every single one of them. And you was mighty persuasive, old George. And then he goes on to say to George, you know, now look, George, how do you want to be remembered in history? Do you want to have a small, little, scrawny gravestone that says, George Wallace, he hated people? Or do you want to have a big marble temple that says, George Wallace, he built for his people? Wallace evidently gets up out of this meeting and goes outside and he says, oh, thank God I got out of there. He would have had me coming out for civil rights.
Thank you. Thank you, Lisa. You're right, a true storyteller.
Thank you, ma'am.
Now, you all know Joe McCarthy, who really is a forum junkie. Joe is here almost as much as Bill White. And you're going to preview a clip of former President Bill Clinton. And were you here that night for
that
forum?
Yes, I was. Yes. And my name really is Joe McCarthy. This is a setup. I just realized that I'm coming between Lisa George and the great Heather Campion, who you will hear from in a moment, and who put on so many of the wonderful forum events here in my youth, in our youth. I don't know why I'm actually up here. I'm more of a consumer. I occasionally moderated forum events when there was no one else around, or when it dealt with Southeastern Europe. I was supposed to know something about Southeastern Europe. Yes, there we are, Southeastern Europe. One Friday afternoon, we had the Prime Minister of Albania and the former Prime Minister of Albania in here on a Friday afternoon. It was a beautiful afternoon. I thought, well, who's going to come to that? Well, my God, the place was packed. They were hanging from the rafters. And it just says something about the forum at the Kennedy School. How many stories should I tell? Most of the evenings I spent here, I was holding up that column back there. And one night, Norman Lear was up here, and he was giving a talk on, he was representing People for the American Way, and he was giving a talk on the evils of stereotypes, and how we should never judge people by their appearances and so forth. It was a good talk. Apparently someone had made some sort of threat or telephone threat or something against Norman Lear. And so there were a lot of HUPD here. A lot of our wonderful Harvard police were here. Steve Singer probably remembers this evening. And so I was holding up the column back there as I usually do, wearing my suit and looking semi-official. And Norman Lear finished his talk and he went in the back and got his coat out of the IOP and he was going out the door and I was standing by the door at that point. And he walked by me and he looked at me and he said, I'd like to thank you and your men. And I said, you're welcome. And he walked by and I thought, well, I wonder what he meant by that. And then I realized, he thought, well, the big Irish guy in the suit must be a plainclothes policeman. Right after he'd given this talk on stereotyping. Well, what was I supposed to talk about? I forgot. Oh, yes, yes. This platform in this wonderful room has served as a sort of launching pad for many presidential hopefuls over the years. And Mike Dukakis, Paul Tsongas, Jack Kemp, Al Gore, on and on the list goes. They've come here to refine their stump speech. And it's a great tribute to the drawing power of this room, the John F. Kennedy Jr. Forum. It also occurs to me that it has something to do with the strategic location of the Kennedy School between Logan Airport and the great state of New Hampshire. So this doesn't hurt
either. Minor detail.
Minor detail.
Come on.
In 1991, a young Southern governor came here and tried out his stump speech and showed us all some of the fire that would get him elected and reelected president of the United States. So without what has already been too much ado, then Governor Bill Clinton.
because I believe that the two substantive issues of this campaign are as follows. One, do we want to continue this 12-year experiment in which the United States is the only major country in the world which says we need no national leadership, no national vision, no national partnership, no national strategy to keep our leadership in the global economy? We can do that with state and local government, 1,000 points of light, and the federal government sort of filling in the blanks. And two, will the President of the United States become an instrument of our national unity, as the President once was, or will he continue to be simply the most visible politician slicing up the electorate in ways that divide but always leave the President with a majority?
Thank you, Joe.
Heather, do them a favor and take the mic from me, quick.
The next presenter is one of the people who really made the forum a world-class venue. Heather Campion was here throughout much of the 90s.
A long time, but I'm still young.
And she's also on the board of the Institute of Politics, so we're so glad you could be here tonight.
Thank you. You know, I was just thinking, actually, we should pause for a moment because Graham Allison was much too modest in describing the origins of the forum. He had this vision, and he can tell you it better than I can at some point, about a Greek and Roman forum in the truest sense, where people got to speak with heads of state and all kinds of dignitaries, people who run nonprofits, the whole, everything that you've seen, as well as have performing arts here. And it's, in my view, the greatest thing about this forum is it's one of the true forums left in this country. And I think we all owe Graham a great deal of gratitude, and every dean since who's held to this tradition of letting audiences really participate. So that leads me to one of my favorite forums. I think the big thing about the forum is frequently the audiences are as informative as the speakers. So let me set the stage for this. This is the Robert McNamara Forum China Incident. Robert McNamara had not been to Harvard since, Graham could tell you the year, in the 1960s when he was Secretary of Defense, and he came to the Harvard came back to the Harvard campus, and there were riots and students overturned his cars and he had to be taken out through the tunnels, and he never returned. And he was very eager to return to his alma mater, but quite nervous about it. So there was a lot of preparation to this forum. I worked very closely with Graham on it. We did everything we could to construct an environment and a panel in which McNamara would feel comfortable. He had just written a book, The Fog of War, that his publishers had gotten him tremendous press coverage for. It was being touted as the big mea culpa, his own history of the Vietnam War, in which, according to the publicists, he had done a mea culpa on Vietnam. So he comes back to Harvard to talk about it. And we'd set up this panel, and the audience, which is hard to tell in this clip, so I want to describe it for a minute, was full of students who were not even alive during the Vietnam War, many faculty members who were students during the Vietnam War, people from the Cambridge community, media. There was a lot of media here. So it was a highly charged atmosphere. And one or two questions into the forum, a woman got up, and this is the clip.
Mr. McNamara, you don't know who I am, but you certainly, for my entire, you poised a situation that created the rest of my adult life. My name is Maureen Dunn. I don't know if you remember the incident, February 14th, 1968, the China incident, where you, the President, the Vice President, Secretary Clifford, General Wheeler, General Taylor, Secretary McNamara, George Christian, Secretary Russ, Tom Johnson, and Walt Rothschild met for 30 minutes about the China incident. Do you remember that?
No.
It was a pilot that was shot down over Hainan Island. Do you remember that incident?
I'm sure I don't.
Okay, well, the thing is, you, on page 6 of the top secret document that I received in 1992, when they, his beeper was heard when he was first shot down, and then 6.5 hours later was heard for 20 to 60, 70 minutes. And you people sat there in that room for 45 minutes, never addressing his name. He was always the China incident. He was 25 years old. So you never had a face to see. I don't know that he had a 25-year-old wife and a baby, a one-year-old baby. This is very emotional for me. I didn't think I would be. But I'm that guy's wife. And you said on page 6, no rescue attempt should be made. Don't go after him. It's not worth it. And all these years, Mr. McNamara, I've wanted someone, and there was 10 people that were at that meeting, to say to me, I am sorry. And I'd like you to say that in front of all these people to me, I am sorry. Please. I just want you to say, I am sorry.
I have no recollection of the meeting, and I can't I haven't seen it, and I'd like to see it. But let me just say this. If I said it, I'm not sorry, I'm horrified.
Well, just, I'd like you to say to me, I'm sorry, Marty.
Well, I'll say I'm sorry, but that's not enough. I am absolutely horrified.
And just to add, following this, of course, the forum was, everyone in the forum was in tears. And at the end of the forum, people just kind of stood around in a daze, and I walked up to one group of people talking, and there were some college students with their mouths open, looking at their professor saying, that was the most intense experience of my college life. And the professor looked at the student and said, that was the way every day of my college life was. And so it went. But there was a conference at Dartmouth College as a result of this forum to analyze McNamara's being and his whole assessment of the history of the war. And it really changed his PR forevermore. He had been on a good trajectory, and I think that one personal incident spoke volumes about the history and who he was. So, thank you.
Thank you, Heather. Okay. Some of you may not know our next presenter because she's often behind the scenes here at the Kennedy School. Beth Banks directs human resources here, and she's been at the Kennedy School since 1986. She really had trouble deciding which forum clip you wanted to.
Yes. Actually, I've been at the Kennedy School since 1984. Let's not forget one of those years. And they've been great years. I've been to many forum events with many deans, with many forum directors, with many directors of the IOP. And I've enjoyed every one of them right through 2005. And a variety of events have occurred that were very personal. The clip that I chose to talk about is one of Julian Bond. And I had the experience of working here at the Kennedy School in computer services, servicing, doing desktop support. And so I'd roam the halls. And one day I was in the IOP and heard a discussion that was pretty fiery. So I popped my head in, and it was Julian Bond with a bunch of undergrads talking about why aren't undergrads into a movement? Why aren't they encouraged to do more for people around them, public service, civil rights? And I just sat down and listened to the entire discussion and got up, and I was really in awe because I thought I work in a place where I can sit down at a table with Julian Bond and hear what he has to say for an hour and get up and continue with my day. And so when he actually had a forum event, I made it a point to come. Growing up as an African American in my home, my parents were very, very into the civil rights movement. My father grew up in North Carolina with segregation. We traveled back and forth through North Carolina to Boston every single year, and they hid segregation from me. And as I became older, they talked about it. And they talked about Jesse Jackson and Julian Bond and Coretta Scott King, who we lost today. And so it was just so timely for me to come to this forum and hear Julian Bond in person. And he was struggling because he said, people really have forgotten. And if you forget your history, you repeat your history. And that scares me every day. So hopefully places like the IOP will bring more activists into our society.
Thank you.
From 1960 until the fall of 1965,
I worked for the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee. I want to discuss first my own experiences with the larger struggle of the right to cast a ballot, and a connected but equally important right to have that ballot counted in a meaningful way. The year following passage of the Voting Rights Act, I was plaintiff in a case which reached the United States Supreme Court and strongly reinforced the right to vote. The case was Bond v. Floyd, and it grew from my first election in 1965 to the Georgia House of Representatives, part of a group who comprised the first blacks in the lower house since Reconstruction. A series of federal lawsuits had reapportioned the Georgia General Assembly, overturning a system where cows and horses were better represented than human beings. The courts ordered new equal districts created in urban Fulton County and ordered elections for a one-year term. As a successful candidate for one of those seats, I was to take the oath of office on January 10, 1966. 7 days before I was to take office, Samuel Young Jr., a Tuskegee Institute student and SNCC worker, was shot and killed while trying to use the segregated bathroom at a Tuskegee service station. Now, Sammy was a Navy veteran. The irony of losing the life he had offered his country over a segregated toilet prompted the release of an anti-war statement by SNCC. On January 6, 1966, we became the first national civil rights organization to link the prosecution of the Vietnam War with the persecution of blacks at home.
Thank you, Beth. And, you know, Beth said something that I feel, and hopefully all of you do too. Some days I come in and I pinch myself to think that here I am working in the heart of a place that brings these kinds of prominent individuals, that has these kinds of discussions about the issues that are facing us in this country and in the world. So, Beth, I agree with you 100%. I can't imagine that I'm here either. Roger Porter, as you all know, is a professor here, and I assume that many of you also know that he has been an advisor to Presidents Ford, Reagan, and the first President Bush, and he has one of my favorite moments from the forum, actually, to introduce this evening.
Well, thank you very much. One of the things that individuals in public life discover is that they are often the subject of a good deal of criticism, and sometimes of individuals who seek to mock or imitate them. This is particularly true with the advent of Saturday Night Live that we have all enjoyed for the last 25 years. Well, shortly after his 1992 election defeat, President Bush sent out a message to those on his staff that they should come to the East Room for an event, and everyone thought that this was going to be an event in which he would tell everybody to buck up and do their best for the last couple of months and have a good life. And we arrived in the East Room, and who walked in but Dana Carvey, who then spent the next half hour imitating George H.W. Bush. Well, the clip we're going to see now is George H.W. Bush here in the forum. And it is a clip which reminds us all that in life, whether we're a politician or not, that we must not take ourselves too seriously and that we should develop the capacity to laugh at ourselves. So here is George H.W. Bush.
I'm not here to criticize the press. Indeed, I've joined press. This is the truth, Press Bashers Anonymous. It's been 10 days since I joined, and I'm going through withdrawal symptoms, but I think Vic's advice was right. So, as Dana Carvey would say, not gonna do it, wouldn't be prudent. He must miss me. He made a killing off of me.
Well, the forum isn't just a venue that attracts students from the Kennedy School and faculty here. It's a venue that brings students from all across the Harvard campus. And our next presenter is Senior Paloma Zepeda, who is a member of the IOP Student Advisory Committee. Paloma, you have a very interesting clip, I understand.
Yes, I think this clip really speaks to why a lot of us come to the forum. We come here and we hear big ideas from all across the political spectrum, from people we might not have heard of, from countries we might never have been to, but we hear these ideas and we get inspired. And I think that the most inspiring part is the bipartisan exchange that happens here a lot of the time. This clip is Senator John McCain speaking in 2001 at the forum, talking about his own moment of bipartisan inspiration.
I went through the Kennedy Library on that day, and I watched Jack Kennedy's speeches. I watched his speeches, first in his inaugural speech. I watched his speech about the Peace Corps. I watched several of his speeches. I am a proud conservative Republican. I am a proud conservative Republican. But I believe that Jack Kennedy had an ability, which is what being president is all about. Ronald Reagan had it. Franklin Delano Roosevelt had it. Theodore Roosevelt had it. And I believe Abraham Lincoln had it as well. And that is the ability to inspire Americans to commit themselves to causes greater than their self-interest.
Thank you. Actually, this one is particularly appropriate because, of course, as most of you know, the Institute of Politics was created to remember former President Kennedy and to inspire people to get involved in politics and public service. So I'm so glad you chose that one. Now, in addition to having the forum as part of what we do at the IOP, we bring in fellows, resident fellows, and we try and connect students with those resident fellows. And Elise Stefanik, who in addition to having been the vice chair at the Institute of Politics last year and being part of vice chair of the Student Advisory Committee at the IOP and being on the Student Advisory Committee, was also the student liaison, one of the student liaisons to Ted Sorensen when he was here as a fellow.
Mm-hmm. The clip you're going to see is fall of 2002. For me, as I'm graduating this year, one of the most memorable experiences of my Harvard undergraduate life, I would say, is coming to Harvard and being able to work with Ted Sorensen on a weekly basis, just listening to someone who had actually been in the room during the Cuban Missile Crisis, who had been there, who had written the words, "Ask not what your country can do for you or what you can do for your country," or had at least helped and advised on the words. This clip is from a forum where Noam Chomsky is speaking about the pending invasion of Iraq. And I was there, I was sitting about four rows behind Ted Sorensen, and in the middle of Chomsky's speech, when he was talking about Kennedy's Cuban policy, I see Ted Sorensen stand up, and Bill White brought over the microphone, and one of the largest lessons I've learned at Harvard is what you'll see on this clip is always stand up for what you believe in, even if you physically have to do so. So
I'm going to veer off for one moment. We have a distinguished fellow here at the Institute of Politics, one Ted Sorensen, and he would like to ask you a question.
Professor, you were quite successful a while back in embarrassing the young questioner who didn't have specific citations to back up his questions to you, but when you come to the Kennedy School and attack John F. Kennedy, I'm listening. Mm-hmm. In two instances, you made two instances. First, you tried to charge Kennedy with a speech given by Dean Acheson to the international
I said a senior,
lawyers.
Remember what I said, a senior advisor of
he was
Kennedy
not a senior advisor. He held no position in the Kennedy administration.
No, but he was an advisor.
And you ought to have
he was an advisor. He was an advisor to the Kennedy administration.
No, he was not. The only advice he gave, which I quoted on this platform 2 weeks ago, Kennedy totally rejected.
Thank you. Ari Rubin, who is one of the members of the IOP Student Advisory Committee, is going to introduce a clip that's particularly poignant for me because I just returned from the Mideast, where I was there for the as part of an observation mission for the Palestinian parliamentary elections, and you're going to show General Zinni talking about what's the conflict in the Middle East.
This was an extraordinary forum with General Anthony Zinni in the fall of 2004, in which he talked about the Middle East post-Saddam and post-Arafat. And it's a really remarkable clip for two reasons. The first is General Zinni talks about peace with an eloquence that only a general can really convey. And the second thing is, as Governor Shaheen pointed out, this is a particularly moving and compelling statement in light of recent events. So,
when I was involved in this process, I had both sides attempting to, quote, win me over. I had the Prime Minister, Sharon, saying, whose side are you on? How do you weigh the situation? On the other side, the same arguments. And I said, if I start making moral judgments and taking positions, then I might as well go home. I'm not a mediator. I've taken a position on our side. There's enough wrong on both sides. There's enough right on both sides. My position out there was, look at your children. You can go back and look at all the injustices were done. We could try to rewrite history. We could try to decide who crapped on what rock 3,000 years ago and never figure it out and not go forward. Look at your kids. Go down the seeds of peace. Watch those Israeli and Palestinian kids who don't come from families that are peaceniks. In many cases, to my surprise, they came from families that didn't want to be there, that had a lot of hate for the other side. But those kids had the guts to say, I want to see for myself. And what they said to me is, if we can figure it out, General, why the hell can't you figure it out and the adults in this process? Now, we can argue about who's right or wrong and who inflicted what horrific act on the other, and we can probably debate that all day. My focus is, you're going to have to put the past behind you, and you're going to have to decide what kind of future you want for your children. If you want them to live under that and you want them to continue the debate, Shimon Peres told me when I got there, you'll meet three kinds of people in this business. You'll meet those that will want to go back and relive history. You're going to meet the righteous. The righteous will throw Bibles and Qurans at you, and there is no compromise. He said the second group you will meet is what he called the collectors of arguments. They're the talking heads you see on TV. They want to debate the issues, make the cases. He said ignore both of them. The third group you're going to meet, and I did meet them, are those kids and those families that just begged me and pulled on my jacket, Israelis and Palestinians, says, help us through this. Let us find a way to live in peace with each other. So my answer to you is not to take a position or side or make a judgment or a moral equivalence or anything else, but I'm willing to help them get through it if they give a damn about their kids. Okay?
Thanks, Ari. I can see why you chose that one. Probably the only person who's been to more forums in the last couple of years than Bill White is Josh Potashnick, who has been here because he's been chair of the forum committee with the student forum committee. And you have a very nice clip picked out for us.
I do. It's a clip of Newt Gingrich, and I'm a Democrat, and everyone in my family is Democrats. And one of my earliest political memories was watching on the night of the 1994 elections, when it became clear that the Republicans had taken over the House, watching a Gingrich rally and my parents saying, oh my God, I can't believe this guy is going to be Speaker of the House. But then, you know, times change, and Speaker Gingrich came here last year, and I was frankly very impressed with a lot of the stuff he had to say. And though I don't always agree with him, I do appreciate his willingness to think out of the box about some really big issues facing the country. And in this clip, he shows one of his particularly provocative ideas. So let's watch.
Right. Let's start just in the poorest neighborhood. So this should be a perfect liberal Democrat proposal. Okay, let's just start with the poorest neighborhoods in America and say in every poor neighborhood in America, we will pay the children who are prepared to go out and study and pass serious tests starting in the seventh grade. What would happen? First of all, you just competed head to head with the pimps, the drug dealers, and the prostitutes as the first people in the neighborhood to have money. Second, you suddenly said the geek who up till now has been ridiculed and despised actually has money. They can go on dates Friday night because they got paid. But I'm sick and tired of being told we have to stay inside the bureaucracy that is failing and pretend the bureaucracy is central to our future. What is central to our future is people learning, not the large, cumbersome bureaucracies that surround them today and that frankly corrupt them.
Newt is provocative. Thank you. We have two more clips before we close this evening, and Mona Mohib is a student, Kennedy School student. Give Mona a round of applause. You're going to introduce a clip from Governor Jennifer Granholm, who was just here last semester and who you helped elect.
This having nothing to do with sitting next to an outstanding former governor. The clip I picked was Governor Jennifer Granholm from Michigan, who many of you saw last semester. And I had a wonderful opportunity to get to know her when she was the Attorney General. And I knew her to be tenacious and a fighter and smart and funny and had this gift that so few elected officials have, which is the ability to really connect with the person in the room and beyond. And a lot of America got to see her up close during the funeral of former civil rights icon, leader, hero, Rosa Parks in Detroit. And the governor, sometimes at almost a whisper, had the rapt attention of not only the people in the congregation, but beyond. And it was with tremendous pride, frankly, when she came here last semester back to her alma mater of Harvard to, for me in a way, to share with my friends and my peers a real role model. In our classes, we discuss leadership and what leadership looks like, and to have live on the stage, and now, thanks to the IOP, forever on the web, a best practice of what real leadership is a source of great pride. And I was so pleased that many of my friends, bipartisan, thought that she was one of the most outstanding speakers we'd had. So, Jennifer Granholm.
You know, I say Dunkin' Donuts because this is the last place I saw this. You go to next to the cash register, and there is like a glass jar with a picture of somebody's Aunt Linda who needs a breast cancer operation. Or did you see the story on eBay earlier this year about the parents who were auctioning off donations or begging for donations for the leukemia treatment for their son? You know, we are not and ought not be a nation of glass jars and eBay healthcare. That, to me, is a moral issue. And now that we have the competitiveness basis as well, I hope that we can get public policy moved in a new direction. Thanks.
Thank you.
I would be remiss, and Bill would kill me if I didn't mention, we talk a lot about the role of naturalized citizens and one day their ability to run for president. And a lot of times we talk about Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger. Well, there's another governor who I would be very proud one day to be able to vote for, my favorite Canadian-born American, Jennifer Granholm.
Thank you. I think it's appropriate that we started this program with former dean, who was instrumental in making the forum happen originally, that we would close it with the current dean, David Elwood. And you've actually picked another one of my favorite clips from forums that I've seen from Nobel Prize winner Wangari Maathai.
Thank you, Jean. It's kind of interesting. I've been dean about a year and a half, and one of the first things I realized as dean is that I was finally going to get really good seats in the forum. And in the meantime, I've had the chance to sit in various positions, often down at the side, while people of great vision inspire, people of great wisdom reveal, people of great courage talk about what they do, and ultimately mostly feel enormously humbled by the kinds of people that are around. I should also say, though, that there's another part of being humbled about this, which is if you come here virtually every night and some extraordinary event is going on, something that many institutions would be proud to have once a year, one of those, there are people, many of them have been announced today, many of them have not, who work tirelessly every minute behind the curtain to make it all work so effortlessly, so seamlessly. And I just want to once again give all of those people, from Jean to everyone in the IOP, the forum office, the technical folks, everyone, a really broad round of applause. They are spectacular. They really, really are terrific. Now, I had trouble, actually, even in the short time, picking some clip that was appealing to me. We've had extraordinary people. Antonin Scalia, particularly appropriate today, but he was really extraordinary here. We had Rick Warren, who most people in the Kennedy School probably hadn't heard of, even though he has the best-selling book of all time about a purpose-driven life. We've had remarkable people, but one of the interesting things that happened to me was just literally within days of being announced as the next dean of the Kennedy School, I was asked to chair my first forum in that context. And the person that was speaking that night was Shireen Aboudi, Nobel Peace Prize winner, who had done, again, extraordinary work in Iran, fighting for children, fighting for rights, and the like. Indeed, what's amazing is how many Nobel Peace Prize winners come through here. There have been three just since I've been dean, and I just quickly looked at the sort of last, 8 or 9 years, and there were seven that have been here, and so you can find all their clips. But the clip tonight is about a different one, Wangari Maathai, who is a woman from Kenya, who's been imprisoned, who's had to fight corrupt government officials, who's fought for the environment and inspired people in many, many different ways. She is a woman of great perseverance and courage and vision, like so many people we've seen. And yet the clip I want to show is not about all the big, bold, dramatic, amazing things that people like her do. It's actually about what it's really like every day when you're trying to make a difference. Here's a clip.
Sometimes when we talk about these issues, it's especially the issues of environment, the issue of governance, the issue of peace, our minds wander away and we feel very discouraged sometimes. We feel like, what can I do as an individual? But the one thing we must do, I said, and I want to repeat, the one thing we must do is we must not allow ourselves to be victims. We must take charge of our lives in whichever way we can. And one of the stories that I want to tell you is a story that I actually had in Japan. When I went to Japan, I learned a lot. And one of the things I learned was this little story, which was told by a Professor Tsuji. We were in a seminar like this, and he told this story. It's the story of a hummingbird. It's the story of a fire breaking out in the forest, a huge fire, and all the animals coming out and standing by the edge of the forest, and feeling extremely overwhelmed, frustrated, don't know what to do, except this hummingbird. It decided that it's going to put out the fire. So it runs, or it flies, both, to the nearest stream. It takes one little drop of water and comes back and puts the drop on the fire, runs back, it's another drop, puts on the fire, keeps running up and down. In the meantime, the animals are watching the hummingbird and they are saying, what are you trying to do? What are you trying to prove? There is nothing you can do. This fire is too overwhelming. You might as well come and join us. And the hummingbird wouldn't stop doing its own thing. It remained committed, patient, persistent. And at one point, it turned to them and said, without stopping its work, I'm doing the best I can. And that, my friends, is all we can be called to do, the best we can. Thank you very much.
A wonderful, wonderful comment. Now, before we let you go, we have just one final clip that we wanted to show everyone because it demonstrates another use for the forum archive, which is the opportunity to be able to go back 15 years ago and see how little someone changes.
have a tall speaker tonight or something.
Note the moderator.
So, stable, so be careful. I am just ecstatic to be here. I think we have a truly remarkable event here put on by the Malcolm Wiener Center for Social Policy and the Institute of Politics here at the Kennedy School. And we're just very, very fortunate. In fact, if I were to make a list of the top five or six people that are having a major impact on children's issues and helping us get back on track, three of them are on this panel tonight. And so I think it's quite extraordinary. But you may be having trouble counting three. There are only two here. Dr. Brazelton was getting an award in Philadelphia today, and he changed his plans to come here. He had a 4:30 flight, but the tunnel's a disaster. So somewhere during this course of the evening, we hope the good doctor will be in, and we're just going to proceed, and he'll respond with great thoughtfulness to the comments of the senator, I'm sure.
So he hasn't changed a bit, do you think?
Thank you.
You know, I think watching this archive, it's made us laugh. Oftentimes, makes us cry when we hear some of the interchanges between the audience and the people speaking. But most of all, it makes us think. And I hope that you will go out and share this with your friends, with your colleagues, because this is living history and how fortunate we are to be in a place where we can participate. I want all of you to know that later tonight we are going to be showing the President's State of the Union address. We also have IOP fellows Al Felsenberg, who is former communications director for the 9/11 Commission, who just arrived yesterday. Al, can you just raise your hand and show us where you are? He will be here. I think Ken Cooper from the Boston Globe is also going to be here. I don't know if Ken's back there in the back of the room, who is also, Ken is also going to be a fellow this semester at the IOP. So we hope that you will stay for the State of the Union address, come back, and have a discussion with Al and Ken about what the President has to say tonight. Again, thank you all for coming, and we hope to see you at the forum again and again.